This is Julie Hartz, the co-founder and CEO of Eventbrite. She founded the company in 2006 with her husband, Kevin. And I'm Stephanie Cohen, I'm the Chief Strategy Officer at Goldman Sachs. So before we get to Eventbrite, let's go before and talk about a place that's not so far from here, Hollywood, and about your career in Hollywood before Eventbrite.
Well, I've only had one career before Eventbrite, so I think that's why we tend to talk about it. It was very short. It was about, in total, 5.5 years. But I came out of Pepperdine and joined MTV to work on Jackass, which was very confusing for my parents. I had the pleasure of seeing that through from the day they sent in their demo tape to the pilot that we spent a bunch of money on to recreate and wasn't nearly as good, to the first series and the movie. And I think why I even mentioned that is because for me it was incredibly formative to see something created by, you know, really a genius. PJ Clapp, who goes by the name of Johnny Knoxville, was in his own right a visionary. And I know that sounds so funny now, but, you know, when they sent the demo, nobody even knew what to do with it. And so to see it become a part of the cultural zeitgeist was a treat. And from there, I went on to FX Networks, where I was fortunate enough to work with one of the best teams in the industry, led by John Landgraf. And so I had this very fortunate early career. And about year three, it was rudely interrupted by Kevin.
And who, by the way, I believe you met here?
I did. So this is the origin of the Hartz story. We met at a wedding. My boss from MTV married a former classmate of his from Stanford, and we sat next to each other during the ceremony, and we've been together ever since. So that was 2003. And Kevin was working on Zoom, his ex-OOM, his second company in the international remittance space, and had been a seed investor in PayPal. And so his background was really around payment processing and platforms at scale. And I came from, obviously, media and had started to think about media consumption and alternative forms of media and consumption. And so when we started to look together at the convergence of tech and media, because we were, you know, going back and forth between Los Angeles, where I lived in Brentwood, and in San Francisco for 2 years, things started to just slowly converge over that time period. Kevin showed me the first mock-ups of YouTube and the first video, and, you know, I took him to the MTV Movie Awards, and then all of a sudden tech company founders were coming down and pitching shows about their stories as reality shows, and Kevin again was showing me that there was going to be disruption when tech met media. And so we finally decided to take the plunge and set up our lives in the Bay Area. And Kevin really pitched me the idea of working together. And ultimately, it was bringing together the idea of experiences as a form of media on a self-service platform that really relied heavily on what Kevin had built in the past in terms of micropayments. And we'll get into it, but obviously everything starts in a very, very small way. And last year we powered 4 million events around the world, sold over 300 million tickets, and 98% of our event creators signed themselves up for the service. So that's 13 years in the making, but the beginning feels like yesterday.
We were talking earlier and you said in some respects it's easier early on and it gets harder as the company gets bigger. Can we talk about that journey for you?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think about, you know, any story of a company, even as we tend to revise history and glamorize it, starts pretty much in the same way. You have an idea. And for Kevin and I, it was, you know, could we build a self-service platform that would enable anyone to bring others together around live experiences? And how could we help scale this form of, you know, gathering, and how important that is to us as human beings? And so could we build a scalable platform that could service that in a self-service manner? And, you know, I think everything starts as an idea. And if you find product market fit and you find early adopters, maybe it can turn into a business if you have the right fundamentals. And then from there, it can maybe turn into a company. And so in the beginning, we started with tech bloggers who were using our platform to charge for meetups. And that was the best group of early adopters because they're very vocal and critical. And so we had this tight feedback loop. It was Kevin, myself, and Renaud Visage, our co-founder. We bootstrapped the company. It was just the three of us for 2 years. And that allowed us to really get very close to our customers. I was the marketing and customer service and finance teams, and Kevin was product, and Renaud was our engineering team. And you know, beyond, I remember the day when we had our first sign up from a non-Silicon Valley tech blogger, and that was a huge day. It was a person who was hosting speed dating events on the East Coast, so it broke both geographical and category bounds, and it was incredibly exciting. I also remember one of our earliest adopters, SneakerCon, which was founded in 2009. It was really one of our sort of first power users of the platform. And to think that they've grown on the platform over the last decade to a place where they have over 100,000 people attending their sneaker cons all over the world, 30 events a year, and what a big part of the cultural zeitgeist that is. You know, being close to these event creators is the best part of my job, but as we scaled and as my role took on new forms and we started to think about growing beyond a business to become a company, there was this gap that started to form. And I was telling Stephanie that, you know, in this past year, as we've become a public company, and even in the journey to become a public company, I made a very intentional effort to rebalance my time and rebalance my focus back to the core and get closer to our creators. So now I spend in the upwards of 30% a week talking to our customers, and especially in the music space, that's it's very exciting and challenging at times. But it's something that I think is so incredibly important to set the right foundation for where we're going. And I just think that so many things can get between you and your customer that you have to become methodical about it. I actually track how much time I spend with our customers in a spreadsheet. Sounds a little nerdy.
Let's talk about early fundraising. What was hard? What was easy?
When we went from that idea stage to maybe we have a business here, it was 2008, which was the worst time ever. So we went out and hit Sand Hill Road, ready to raise our first institutional round, and we received 27 no's. And what we did in that time was, because obviously the sky is falling, it was the end of 2008, we couldn't literally have picked a better time, or worse time. What we did was we left our business plan for 2009 with all of these investors and said, we'll be back next year to, you know, tell you how we did against that plan. And I think they were surprised by our boldness and transparency in a year where many people wondered if they'd be even existing in 12 months. We ended up having a great year. The thing about long tail experiences and the tickets that we sell is they're low price. The thing about our self-service platform is it's also low cost. So we fared well during 2009. We actually saw some really great growth. And so we went back to Sand Hill Road at the end of 2009, and it was a different story. It was nothing like what you see today. But we got three term sheets, and we were able to choose our top firm, which was Sequoia Capital, and then it was just off to the races. So the follow-on rounds were very different, larger, easier, and then of course we did the ultimate fundraise last year and went public.
What was fun, if anything, during the IPO? What wasn't? And then let's talk about the first year of being public and dealing with quarterly earnings and just the public nature of being public.
I loved it because I think the process of going public forces you to codify your values. You know what your mission is, and you say it a lot. And when you're growing and you're a company of a certain size, it's ingrained in everything you do. But you have some choices. And because nobody really truly understood what we did, we had to figure out what kind of narrative we would use. And we used the stories of our event creators as the basis of our narrative. So that was really fun to be able to go out. And I didn't know if it would work in the room. And the first meeting we had, when I just dropped right into a story, I could tell that it worked. And that was so great because I had this library of stories to choose from. So it never became boring. I mean, I grew up dancing, so I sort of love the performing aspect, but it was really fun. We had the most amount of travel adventures, I think, that at least George Lee said he'd ever seen in an IPO roadshow. We never quite ever landed where we were supposed to, so that was interesting. But it was just it was a great way to sort of force that codification of who are we, what are we doing, who are we serving, why are they buying what we build. And I think a great way to set the stage for the next phase of the company.
So that's a reasonably positive view on it, an IPO. Yeah, so thank you.
I'm in a rare group of people who really enjoyed the process.
Okay, so let's talk about some of the harder parts of being a public company, which is quarterly earnings, and you're integrating acquisitions, and you're running a company, and you're dealing with the culture of doing that. What is that like? How do you make sure that you're focused on what's important and deal with the public market at the same time?
I was thinking about this recently. I wouldn't say it's been a roller coaster. It's been like that ride. I don't know if you've ever gone to like a Tower of Terror or something where you go up and then there's this extra special one in Sweden where they flip you at the last second forward and so you fall on your face. It's sort of like that on any given day. It's been a really challenging year for us, but a gratifying year because I think that what we have faced as a newly public company where we've kind of tripped a couple times is just the fortitude. I mean, I think of sort of why we do what we do and why we get up every day as founders or CEOs or operating executives. And, you know, there aren't a lot of people who ask you how you're really doing. And that's the beauty of this group, is that you can actually do that in this setting. But it is really truly about how you show up in the hard times that defines you, and also the fortitude to keep going. And I think that's what truly makes the champion companies and founders and CEOs. And so I have a lot of stories now where I think before I you know, we had kind of a boring trajectory, and now it's like, wow, I could tell you a lot about what not to do and how to recover from what not to do, and also how to build the team for the next phase of growth. Now I have the right team in place and the right plan, and the business is stabilized, and that feels so good. I think I would have taken that for granted prior.
So let's talk a little bit about culture. You've gotten a bunch of awards. The company's gotten a bunch of awards. Can we talk about how you did that from the beginning in terms of getting the culture right, and then how you've managed to keep the culture?
Well, I think it's when I look back on how we built the company, when it became clear that we would actually become a company, because again, I think it's not, we shouldn't have entitlements that our business will become a company. I think it became very clear that who we are as people, as founders, was going to lay the foundation for the culture. And that's, so it's kind of like a tip to look at yourself and understand your core values, because inherently it will be reflected in the culture of your company, good and bad. And so when we started hiring, it wasn't until about 3 years in, and you know, we were able to really be thoughtful about what kind of company we want to build. And frankly, and very personally, that's what drives me, is thinking about building a great company. I think oftentimes we get caught in maybe a cycle or a pattern of being asked, you know, what are your favorite companies, or who are your favorite CEOs? And I think the idea to emulate another company or another CEO is really dangerous. I try to pull, you know, concepts from great leaders or great companies and pattern match them against each other, because you never get the full story. I think if we deify founders or certain companies, that's just a dangerous practice, because there's a whole lot more to the story. And putting that together and making sure that the culture's never stagnating, so you're always bringing in new ideas, you're always sort of pushing the culture forward in a way that evolves with the times and the stage of the company. And then finally, we've made a very concerted effort to hire outside of San Francisco, and that's been something we've done for the last 6 years. So building a fully distributed, office work culture that's globally inclusive, that is challenging, but it also has some great upside. And so the challenge is obvious, I think, communication flow and everybody feeling a part of the mission and feeling like they can really thrive and have growth outside of San Francisco. the major upside is the competitive advantage we have to tap into different pockets of talent and to distribute the investment and activate the global talent network, which I think is alive and well. You just have to find the right groupings of people.
So you've talked a little bit now about recruiting and finding the right people. Do you have any advice or tricks around how you make sure that you find the right people and then they actually say yes to you?
I think so. I think one of the great pieces of advice that I've been given is don't make hiring mistakes, but if you do make them, fix them quickly. So I think in the process of figuring out what works for each stage of the company, I've adopted a practice of whether it's filling a position that we know will fill internally or going out to find new talent to join the team, to start very, very, very abstractly. So not to start with names or people in mind, but really to start with what is the problem we're trying to solve on behalf of our customers. So we start each job rec that way. And if you were to solve that problem in the most effective and efficient way, which skills would you need to have? And if you were to create the highest quality outcome for your customers, what experience would lend itself to the skills that you need? And finally, what types of attributes do we need in our company that aren't already in the company? So driving towards that idea that you can't just hire all the same type of people, which happens. And then finally, we'll start looking at resumes from there. And every time we stick to that process religiously, we have a great outcome. Every time we start thinking about names too soon, or we start shuffling people around because it's convenient, it doesn't work out.
How much of your time is spent with investors today?
Well, it's funny. I was I telling you about the penalty box? It's kind of, you know, you get like if you disappoint Wall Street, you get put in a penalty box. And it's kind of nice in the penalty box. I would say that I probably don't want to be in it for that long, but. But you know, it's the reason why I say it's not, I guess I'm always looking at the silver lining. We kind of get this nice air cover to build the company over the long term, and you know, we kind of got the disappointing part out of the way. I remember talking to Brian Halligan from HubSpot, and I think he's reported 19 quarters without missing or something, and he's like, what is it like to miss? And it was our first quarter. I'm like, oh well, Brian, let me tell you. I'm just sort of really enjoying the opportunity to build the company. I mean, we have money on the balance sheet. We're a really efficient business. People are gathering all over the world. You know, there's really not a whole lot that gets in our way. It's just it's ourselves. And so to get to your question, I spend, 15 to 20% of my time on investor-related activities and meeting with investors. But I'm always talking to our top five investors who have been with us for a long time. It's just a constant conversation. And you know, that's something that I learned as a early entrepreneur, is just to keep the conversation going in a very productive manner. And that's been helpful because the long-term investors aren't put off by penalty box. The value investors actually really like it when you're in the penalty box.
Well, I think that's a perfect place to end.
Thank you.
Thanks, Julia.